We're back with another lesson. First and foremost, I want to give all praise, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shah, Bahashem, Mohammed Kakodash, Barakatha Yahweh, Barakatha Yahweh Shah. Double honest to the apostles and the elders, a great millstone who taught me this truth. Shalom to you, Akim and Akwaf, that believe and have faith in Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahweh Shah, in these last days. It's got a couple of videos, basically going into war. And we are going to enter World War III faster than anybody can blink their eyes, man. We know it's one major prophecy that must happen before that happens, but we're at the beginning of these things to come to pass, man. World War III, Battle of Armageddon, as the scriptures mention.
NATO flag was destroyed at a massive protest in Paris. Tens of thousands of people took the street and kept chanting, "Let's get up NATO, no missiles for Ukraine." The French people don't want World War III. They do not want to keep funding the war in Ukraine. They said NATO is war. We don't want to be involved in this conflict at all. Macron, Jojo, we don't want it. At the same time, massive protests continued all over France against Macron and his pension reform plan. However, the mainstream media doesn't want to report these incidents. In Spain, massive demonstrations took place in Madrid. Hundreds of thousands of Spanish health workers took the street to protest over the state of the health system. A protester named Lillian Ramirez told Reuters that they have cut our wages instead of raising them. We're overwhelmed with work and do not have any support. We're in danger of extinction. Thank you so much for watching and see you later.
As you see, these protests are not being covered by any news outlets, man. None of these protests are being covered, even the one in America. This is on 220. Anti-war rally in Washington, D.C. on 220, man. Thousands of protesters calling for the U.S. to stop supporting Ukraine in the war.
What a news is it? All these news folks. Tell me what the news is. All propaganda, I'm telling you. Look at that shit. Look at it. Why ain't that on the news? We ain't trying to go to war with no Russia. Y'all need to get y'all ass from out of there, bro. Our leader is trying to kill us, bro. I'm telling you. Not one part of news coverage on this.
But the thing is, they can't reverse biblical prophecy. So these things, these wars must come to pass.
The United States, as I just said, put Ukraine on notice. There is nothing left to give. We've got nothing left to give you. Keep in mind, people go, wait a minute, the United States is big. We're getting ready to fight a war with China. So we have a lot of equipment that has to be earmarked to go to China. We have North Korea acting up. We have a lot of equipment that's earmarked for that. We have Middle East contingencies. So much of the United States military capacity cannot be committed to a conflict in Europe, in Ukraine. So there's a very limited amount of equipment, material, and support that we can provide, and we've pretty much tapped it out. NATO, as I said, is totally dysfunctional. The Germans had to cannibalize brigades to get a battalion sent to their Lithuanian deployment. There's nothing left to cannibalize. We're down to one battalion of the Leopard A2s, A5s, I guess, A7s. That's a modern one, A7s. They've got nothing. The French, they've got nothing. Who has anything? The British? You can put the entire British military into a soccer stadium and have 30,000 unsold seats. So, you know, NATO literally has nothing to give. No equipment, no organization. Their air forces don't fly. Don't count all the German aircraft that appear on paper. 60% of them can't get off the ground because they haven't been maintained. You don't have pilots. If they do get off the ground, Europe has about 2 weeks worth of air-to-air missiles. Why? Because they've never planned for a large-scale combat where you're going to be in continuous air. When was the last time a European fighter shot anything down? When was the last time an American fighter shot anything down? We don't do air-to-air combat. So, Pardon?
The balloon. Oh, they shot the balloon. The Chinese.
There you go. We've got some really good balloon guys.
little balloon yeah. sign. They had, you know, the first kilo of F-22 ever.
Yeah, great. And I mean, our missile to target ratio is pretty good, right? $200,000-$400,000 missiles to shoot down one $2,000 balloon. Take that price ratio every time. No, you know, my point is the West is, again, I defer to the commander of all NATO forces in Europe. NATO's not ready for this. They didn't envision it. They can't imagine it. They hadn't imagined it. No NATO country has been putting the resources necessary to prepare for this. They don't have reserves. They don't have ammunition stocks. They don't have fuel stocks. You can't fight a war unless you have the logistics in place. NATO was designed for short, quick, duration operations. And this is a long, grinding out war. I don't see this ending well for the Ukrainians for any number of reasons. Corruption. So, but I will say this, again, referring to Prigozhin, the head of Wagner. The Ukrainians ain't cowards. And I mean, you can disagree ideologically with the nationalist units. I do, vociferously. You can question the motivation of some of these troops. But when push comes to shove, these guys are fighting. They're fighting hard. Prigozhin says so. He says these guys have steel cojones. So, you know, let's keep in mind that this is a real war. This isn't a one-sided fight. This isn't Russia rolling over the Ukrainians. This is a bloody battle, street by street, house by house, block by block, tree line by tree line.
Yeah, as you see, man, he pretty much laying it out, man. He's being honest. He's not being one side. He's just being honest, man. The Lord, Yahweh Bashem Yahshua, is forcing Esau's hand. And the pride of the Edomites, like this guy, he doesn't see it happening, man. He thinks that they are going to win and take over Russia, man.
There's an infuriating article in the Wall Street Journal today about how the French and the Germans are basically trying to surrender again. Let me read you some captions. It's just horrific. So, from a French official, we keep repeating that Russia mustn't win. But what does that mean? I don't know. It's hypothetical. Oh, so interesting question. If the war goes on for long enough with this intensity, Ukraine's losses will become unbearable, senior French official says. And no one believes they will be able to retrieve Crimea. Actually, retired General Ben Hodges thinks they can retrieve Crimea. Retired General Wesley Clark thinks they can retrieve Crimea. These are two America's top generals. Lots of people think they can retrieve Crimea. But even so, Crimea is maybe 25% of Ukrainian territory that the Russians have stolen. There is still 75% of the rest of the territory that will be easier than Crimea for the Ukrainians to get back. So why wouldn't we want them to at least try to get that back first? But oh, there's a catch. Part of the reason they can't get all of this back very easily is because we won't give them the weapons they need to get it back. We won't give them the long-range missiles. We won't give them the fighter jets. I mean, there's in the tanks, we only decided 3 weeks ago to give them the tanks, and the American tanks, for example, may not arrive for a year. So don't give me this, oh, they can't get it all back because we haven't given them the weapons to get it back, but also that's BS to say they can't get back Crimea. The other thing, for the French to say, oh, if the battle goes on like this, their losses will become unbearable, and they're suggesting that therefore we must force the Ukrainians to negotiate with the Russians. Don't you think the choice should be the Ukrainians as to whether the losses are unbearable, trying to get their own country back, not up to France? There's more. Over dinner at the Élysée Palace, the sumptuous seat of the French presidency, Mr. Macron delivered a more sober message. The people said, telling Mr. Zelensky that even mortal enemies like France and Germany had to make peace after World War II. Yeah, they made peace after we utterly destroyed Germany, marched onto Berlin, and basically forced Hitler to kill himself. Secondly, it's not like the French had a really valiant role if you talk to people, historians. At least there's a debate as to what role the French really played in, you know, hanging out till the end. One could argue that the French were a little too willing to make peace with Hitler, but in any case, we marched to Berlin and basically killed the guy. Then we made peace. Finally, The pact being floated. Oh, NATO's floating a pact now. The pact being floated with Ukraine wouldn't include any commitment to station NATO forces in Ukraine, the three countries' officials said. Neither would it offer Kyiv so-called Article 5 protection, which requires all members to come to another's rescue if it is attacked and request assistance. But they said it would provide Ukraine with the military means to deter any future Russian attack. In other words, we're going to... Oh, this is too long. You know what? I'm going to continue this in the second video because I'm so pissed off. Second video coming up.
Yeah. Those other nations are not stupid as he is, because they know that they don't, they are going to be targets if they continue to, you know, supply the yellow and blue country with high with those weapons that they're requesting, man, the ships and fucking aircraft and long range missiles. They know that Russia can hit them with nuclear missiles, man. This is common sense. You don't have to be a military guy to understand common sense. If those France and those other countries know, if they continue to provide the yellow and blue state, I would say, with those weapons, that they're going to be targets themselves. America doesn't care. They are benefiting from the war. But these other Western European countries are not benefiting from the war. Basically, it hurt them for the yellow and blue state to go to war with them, with Russia. Because their gas and all their imports from Russia has basically been taken away. And they have to buy higher gas and oil from America. But I just brought this up right here. It says U.S. defense spending compared to other countries, man. So all them other countries benefit. They benefit. They don't really benefit from war as America benefits from war. As you see, they spending the spending budgets of all these countries combined compared to the U.S. And it's another chart compared to comparing U.S. individually, how they spend their money. It says countries, this is back in 2019, it pretty much hasn't changed. The countries with the highest military spending in 2019, and this is the latest one I've seen. But as you can see, Japan, 47.6 billion, 48, 49, 50, 61, 65, Russia, 65. The only one that's close is China. And that's the biggest thorn in America's side right now. And they're going to go to war. But America can't continue to give these military weapons and prolong the war with Russia as they've been doing. Because they're going to have to get prepared to go to war with China. And they threatened China Friday if they supply Russia with military equipment, that they're basically they're giving them a warning to not supply them with military equipment. So it's getting thicker than anybody can ever believe it would be. And the Lord is pushing the European countries into a corner, man. And that goes back into Revelation 17, close to the end of the chapter, man. That they're gonna go against America, because it's not going to benefit them for the yellow and blue country to go to war. It's not benefiting them. They're going to have to subject their own nation to war. And you see those protests. They don't want to go to war. But they have to. This is Exodus 3, 15 in verse 3. It says, Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai is a man of war. Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai is his name. And the Lord is mustering the war. He's mustering these armies to battle, man. You know, Babylon the Great pushing these wars all over the country, man. They're going to have to fight on like four or five different fronts with Russia, with China, with North Korea, with Iran. And that's four fronts right there. The European countries don't want to go to war. And you can just tell by their people, they don't want to go to war. But they're going to be forced to go to war because the Lord is going to make them go to war. This is Jeremiah 50. Now I'm going to drop down to verse 40. You know, we done touched on these scriptures several times, but we kind of got to reiterate these scriptures because we get closer and closer to war and these prophecies are coming to pass. This is Jeremiah 50 and 40. It says, as power overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah and the neighboring cities thereof, saith Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai, so shall no man abide there. Neither shall any son of man dwell therein. And that's Babylon the Great. It's like he's going to do Sodom and Gomorrah. He's doing the Babylon the Great. He's stirring up the nations now for this to come to pass. Behold, a people shall come from the north, and a great nation, and kings, and many kings shall be raised up from the coast of the earth. They shall hold the bow and lance. They are cruel and will not show mercy. And that's talking about Russia and China. It says, their voice shall roar like the sea, and they shall ride up upon horses, everyone put in array like a man of battle against thee, O daughter of Babylon. So all these nations are ready for war against Babylon the Great, man. As you see, it says daughter of Babylon, not the ancient Babylon, but the one we stand in America, Babylon the Great. It says, and the king of Babylon have heard the report of them, and his hand waxed feeble. That's talking about Biden, the modern day Pharaoh, the Babylon, the modern day king of Babylon. He says, anguish took hold of him and pangs as a woman in travail, man. So he's going to be in bad case, man, when all hell break loose and war is going to have to commence. They pushing it now. They standing in great pride right now. As you seen the guy in the last video, he's standing in great pride wanting this war to continue. But they don't know that this is going to be the end of Babylon the Great and the kingdom of Esau. Behold, he shall come up like a lion from the swelling of Jordan unto the inhabitation of the strong. But I will make him suddenly run away from her. And who is a chosen man that I may appoint over her? For who is like me? And who will appoint me the time? And who is that shepherd that will stand before me? Therefore, hear ye the counsel of Yahweh Bashem Yahushua, that he hath taken against Babylon, and has purposed against the land of the Chaldees. Surely the least of the flock shall draw them out. And that's going into these smaller nations, which we know for a fact is going to be Israel. It's in the land of Israel. He's going to draw out he's going to start the war with all the nations. He's going to make America be forced to fight. So now there's basically like spurring. They're using these proxy wars to get to weaken each other. They're using all these proxy wars to weaken each other's country, like America using a yellow and blue country to weaken Russia. But it's basically, it's continuing to make them stronger and making their country unite for war. As you've seen in Putin's speech, man, he has those people roused up to go to war. They're not standing like Europe and these other countries, man, even America. They're not standing to go to war because they know that that America is basically starting it. 46, it says, surely the end of 45, it says, surely the least of the flock shall draw them out. Surely he shall make their habitations desolate with them. Israel is going to make America get destroyed just as well as Israel is going to be destroyed as well. It says, at the noise of the taking of Babylon, the earth is moved. And that goes in Isaiah 24 when those missiles hit ground zero, man. At the taking of Babylon, and the cry is heard among the nations. So all these nations are going to know when America get hit by nuclear missiles, man. They're going to know right off the bat. This is the Lord's judgment, because it's going to be so many missiles that come to Babylon the Great. You ain't going to be able to count them, man. But through the scriptures, we know it's going to be 200 million missiles, man. That's in Revelations 9. But we know it's going to be so many missiles that hit. It's going to move the earth, man. The earth going to reel to and fro like a drunkard, man. This is Revelations 18, and I'm going to just start at verse 1. It says, and after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having a great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and caged in every unclean and hateful bird. And that's what we're in right now, man. Because basically it's gonna really be physical with those animals dwelling in this land once it's utterly wasted. But these devils are here now, man. Esau, Edom, man. It says, for all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have waxed rich through her abundance of her delicacies, and they have waxed rich. All the weapons that they sell, they call it, Trump was making a big deal about the military complex or whatever. They get paid off of making these weapons for these smaller nations to destroy their armies, man. They make a lot of money, man. That's what America is basically. That's the last stronghold America has to sell to other nations is weapons. That's the only thing they have to provide for anybody is weapons. And basically, America has been stretched too far, man. They have so many bases, as Putin touched on that. Same thing happened to Rome. They were stretched too thin. They had too many bases. They didn't have enough people to manage them. The country was falling. The dollar was collapsing. History repeats itself, man, and that's true. And they're in the worst case now because these other nations don't want to fight, man. Verse 4, it says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and ye receive none of her plagues. And that's talking about you Israelites. It says, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and power hath remembered her iniquities. And it's talking about Babylon the Great, man. The Lord has remembered this place. Verse 6, it says, reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works. In the cup which she hath filled to her double, man. So everything she done, she's going to get double, man. And she's going to get double. Everything she did around these countries, around the nations, to the people of Israel, she's going to get double compared to what she's done. How much has she glorified herself and lived deliciously? So much torment and sorrow give her, for she had in her heart, I set a queen and am no widow. And that's where the pride of the people, man, is thinking that America is going to be able to go and continue to destroy these other nations, and nobody's ever going to stand up to her. And now you see that North Korea, being a small nation, they're standing up to America. Russia, China, Iran. That's just a number off the top of my head, the countries off the top of my head. But all these other nations have become prideful against her, man, because they know that they have no backing and nobody's backing them anymore, man. All these other nations are basically fleeing away from them. When World War III starts, Babylon the Great is going to have those Great Britain, France, and all these other countries, NATO allies. But once they see America's being taken, they're going to turn on America, man. They're going to turn on them. And this is biblical prophecy. It says, verse 7 again, how much she have glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she have in her heart, I said, a queen and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. So these nations, like he said, the generals know that they can't go and say the blue and yellow country can win. I mean, can lose. They can't say that, man, because it will go against everything America's trying to do. So, yeah, they got to say, yeah, they can win. They can get Crimea back and get all these nations back that have been taken. And they know in their mind that they can't take these countries back. That's why the French want them to negotiate a peace agreement with Russia, because they see that they can't fight against them anymore and win. I think they suffered over 300-some-odd troop loss, 300,000 troop loss so far. Verse 8, it says, therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death, mourning, and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. For strong is Yahweh Bashem Yahushua that judgeth her. Revelation 18, you can read the whole chapter. It describes America to the T. And it's telling you she's going to be utterly burned with fire. In one day, all these things are going to come, man. Everything's going to be a trickle effect. Everything going to happen in one day. Because it's going to lead up to 1 hour, she's going to be destroyed. Let me drop down and get that real quick. Slovakia. Revelation 18, verse 19, it says, and cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, what city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust upon their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all this. It's like all that, slacker, I'm about to sneeze. It says, wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour is she made desolate. 1 hour, America is going to be destroyed. And this is the will of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai. Just like he's destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, it's the same judgment America's going to get, man. We just read that in the beginning of the lesson. This is Isaiah 34. I'm starting at verse 1. It says, come near ye nations and hear, and hearken ye people. Let the earth hear, and all that is therein, the world and all things that come forth of it. So the Lord giving everybody a warning of what was coming. For the indignation of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shah is upon all nations, and his fury upon all their armies. He hath utterly destroyed them. He hath delivered them to the slaughter. So the Lord has prepared for these nations and their armies to be destroyed, and no one can reverse it. The Lord's judgment has went out, and no one can turn it back. This is Psalms 49. And this is all for the controversy of Zion, man, for the children of Israel, the hopeful elect. The Lord is destroying all these armies for what they did, for what the nations did to his people. This is Psalms 49, Psalm of Korinth, verse 1. It says, hear this, O Slaka, hear this, all ye people, give ear, all ye inhabitants of the world. But both low and high, rich and poor together, my mouth shall speak of wisdom, and the meditation of my heart shall be of understanding. It says, and I will incline my ear to a parable. I will open my dark sayings upon the harp. And this is a dark saying, man. A lot of people can't understand that the Lord is going to destroy America, man. A lot of people can't understand that. Verse 5, it says, wherefore should I fear in the days of evil, when the iniquity of my heels shall compass me about? They that trust in their wealth and boast themselves in the multitude of their riches, which they do, they boast themselves in the military of America, man, the riches and what they spend on their military yearly, man. They boast themselves in that no one ever is going to be able to touch them. And I'm talking about Americans, man. They boast themselves in the riches and their military power. They boast themselves in it. It says, they that trust in their wealth and boast in themselves in the multitude of their riches, none of them can be, Slaka, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give power a ransom for him. So you can't save your own, you can't even save your own people, man. The Lord is going to judge this place, man. It says, for the redemption of their souls is precious, and it ceaseth forever, that should still live forever and not see corruption. For he seeth that the wisdom of man die. See, these people have a lot of pride and wisdom in wickedness, man. And the Lord says, for he seeth that the wise men die, likewise the fool and the brutish person perish, and leave their wealth to others. So that's what's going to happen to America, man. They're going to perish, and their wealth is going to come to us, man. And that's talking about, that's going into the elites, because they don't rape, rob, and murder people through Babylon the Great. They stole gold, riches from these other nations, and hoarded everything that the earth has by using America, Babylon the Great. And it says, verse 10 again, he said, he seeth that wise men die, likewise fool and brutish person perish and leave their wealth to others. So they're going to vomit all their wealth up. And it goes into it in Job 20. I think it's Job 20. It goes, they're going to give everything back, man. You know, like in that movie, Wakanda, when he, the first one, when he went and seen all the basically the treasures that we had, they have in their museums. That's true, man. Because those treasures, I think it was a mask they got from Benin, and that was from the tribe of Judah on the west coast of Africa. They stole that, man. They still got it to this very day. Let me get back to it, man. I got a lot, about five more scriptures I want to get. This is Revelations 9. And just to point in verse 12, it says, woe, it's like one woe is past. Behold, there come two woes more here afterward. It says, let me read that again. I said afterward, but it wasn't. It said, verse 12, it says, and this is one woe symbolizing the one world war is already passed. One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter. So two more woes are supposed to come after the first one. And it goes into the, let me get it real quick. It says, and they, it's like a, and they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit. This already pretty much happened. Whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. And that was basically going into the first World War. This is Revelations 11. In verse 14, it says, the second war is past. Behold, the third war cometh quickly. And that's what we're going into, man. The third world war. And that's coming quickly. This is Revelation 16. And drop down to verse 15. It says, behold, I come as a thief. This is Yahweh Bashem Yahushua. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon, which is World War III, man. So the Lord is gathering them in the Middle East for the Battle of Armageddon. You can read up in Revelation 16 and get the understanding of that. So the Battle of Armageddon is fin to commit. Verse 17, it says, and the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, it is done. So the destruction is already completed, man. We just wait for it to manifest in the physical. Everything is done. The Lord has already established what's going to happen, who's going to win, who's going to lose. It's already rigged, man. But we're going to see it happen and manifest in the physical. And Revelation 18, I already really think I got Revelation 18. But I'm going to start it. Yeah, I read it already, but I'll read it again. This is Revelation 18. Just dropping down to 16. It says, and saying, at last, that great city that was clothed with fine linen and purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, for in 1 hour so great riches is come to naught. And every shipmaster and all the company of ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea stood afar off. And a lot of trade is done in America by sea. They still do a lot of trade from China and these other nations by sea. So they said they stood afar off and cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, what city is like unto this great city? And they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, at last, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour is she made desolate. So the Lord is going to destroy this place in 1 hour, man. And it's for the children of Israel. Verse 20 says, rejoice over her, thou heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets, for power hath avenged you on her. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, saying, thus with violence shall that great city Babylon be thrown down and shall be found no more at all. So the Lord, when the Lord destroyed this place, man, it's never going to be found again, man. And that great millstone symbolizing those, that stone that hit Daniel's statue, man. Destroyed it. Because this is the Lord's doing, man. The Lord is mustering the host of the battle, man. This is Isaiah 63. And everybody should know this one by now. But you have to get it because it goes right along with it, man. It said, who is this to come from Edom with dire garments from Bozrah? This that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I that speaketh in righteousness, mighty to save. Yahawashah, man. He says, wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the wine fat? Basically stomping them out, man. And I had trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me. For I will tread them in my anger and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon all, sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment. For the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of my redeem is come. And I looked, and there was none to help. So nobody's going to help Esau when he brings judgment, man. They're going to clear it out and let Esau be destroyed, man. And I wonder, and Esau is these other nations too. Just don't think it's just the so-called white men here in America. But France and Russia and China, because they're going to turn and fight against the Lord too once they destroy America. And the Lord is going to utterly waste these people, man, these other nations. It says, and I looked, and there was none to help. And I wondered that there was none to uphold. Therefore, my own arm brought salvation unto me, and my fury, it lifted me, it upheld me. So the Lord's judgment was going to be righteous on these people, man. And it's going to be worth it. When they be destroyed, it's going to be worth the Lord's destruction, in other words. Verse 6, it says, and I will tread down the people in my anger and make them drunk in my fury, and I will bring down their strength to the earth. So the Lord's going to bring down his strength, and that's their weapons, man. Esau was blessed with the sword, and the Lord going to bring them down by their weapons, man. Their strength is going to be taken down. And they're not going to be able to defend themselves from Yahweh Bashem Yahushua, because when he bring them down, it's going to be it. They'll never have another rulership on a planet Earth again. This is Jeremiah 25. And drop down to verse 30. It says, therefore prophesy thou against them all these words, and say unto them, Yahweh Bashem Yahushua shall roar from on high and utter his voice from his holy habitation. He shall mightily roar upon his habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against all the inhabitants of the earth. And it's talking about when he said in 63, when he coming down and trample them in his fury. He says, a noise shall come even to the ends of the earth, for Yahweh Bashem Yahushua have a controversy with the nations. He will plead with all flesh. He will give them that are wicked to the sword, saith Yahweh Bashem Yahushua. Thus saith Yahweh Bashem Yahushua of hosts, behold, evil shall go forth from nation to nation, and a great whirlwind shall be raised up from the coast of the earth. And that's him, man. The Lord is bringing great destruction on these people, man. They think they're just going to fight, you know, go and fight and destroy this country, and the elite's going to establish their new world order, and they're going to basically ride off into the sunsets. But no, man, the Lord said when he comes, it's going to be these nations going to be fighting against each other. And he's going to come like a great whirlwind raised up from the coast of the earth, man. It's going to be beautiful, man. Verse 33, it says, and the slain of Yahweh Bashem Yahusha shall be at that day from one end of the earth even unto the other end of the earth. So it's going to be the Lord going to be killing people from from California to Africa to Jerusalem, all the way, man, over here, man. All over the earth is going to be death. The Lord going to be leaving a trail of dead bodies all over the earth. They shall not be lamented, neither gathered nor buried. They shall be dung upon the ground. So the Lord said he's going to leave them like just dung on the ground, man. He's going to be killing from all over the planet, man. From China to Russia to shit over to America. It's going to be a lot of death the Lord is going to bring, man. And these fake pastors teaching these people that they're going to prosper and the Lord is going to bless them with cookies and treats and shit. And kiddie shit, man, not telling them people, man, the Lord, man, get right with the Lord, because the Lord is bringing great destruction on this place, man. Just like he did in Sodom. I guess people forgot about Sodom and Gomorrah, man. That's what it is, man. These people forgot about the Lord's judgment, man. They forgot about Moses leading the children of Israel out of Egypt and destroying the Pharaoh's army. They forgot about Noah being closed in the ark, and then these people, the rest was flooded out and died in the flood, man. They forgot about that, man. Sodom and Gomorrah, and the Lord sent fire from heaven. These people are going to be reminded real soon, man. The Lord's judgment, and the Lord is powerful. This is Revelation 19. I'm going to start at verse 11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doeth judge and make war. And that's Yahweh Bashim Yahushua. He's making war, man. If you don't see it, the Lord is making war with these nations. He's getting them stirred up against each other for him to come and fight. He want to fight everybody, man. That's why he's going to make war with every. He want everybody to fight, man. It's going to be a world war. Man. Verse 12, it says, his eyes were as the flame of fire, and his head were many crowns. And it's clearly talking about Yahweh Shah. And he had a name written that no man knew but him, he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, in the same vesture he was talking about in Isaiah 63. And his name is called the Word of Power. And the armies which were in heaven followed him, and that's talking about the angels, followed him upon white horses clothed in fine linen, white and clean. So ain't nothing going to touch them, man. They're going to be beautiful, man, them chariots. Esau can't claim he's shooting down the Lord's chariots, man. He can't claim that, man. That's stupid. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword. And that's those concentrated fire laser beams. That with it he should smite the nations. He's going to be smiting the nations with them, man, with those concentrated fire. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of his furiousness, of his wrath of the Almighty. Let me read that again. Verse 15, it says, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of his fierceness, and the wrath of the Almighty Power. Yahweh Bashem Yahushua, and he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Yahweh Bashem Yahushua, man. That's exactly who is coming. The Son of the Most High Power to bring all these other nations down, man. So Lord willing, was edifying. I'm in it there. Shalom.